So in this video, we will cover the important cases with respect to the mergers, that is section 232, right? The scheme of arrangement. So these all cases I have cropped it from the ICSI module, and I have already sent you the PDF, but now I'll be just discussing about what all these cases are so that you just remember the broad points. It's not necessary to remember the case name except for the Mafatlal and Hindustan Lever case. You don't have to actually remember the case name, even though in the exam they ask you what is the case name, but even if you remember the provision, you will be able to answer the question. So this is one case, which is Sisa Industries Limited, and in this case it said that the Supreme Court opined that the court, right? So if you remember section 232, it says that the NCLT is going to examine, right? It's not binding on the NCLT. If you read section 230 subsection 6, even if the majority shareholders, they approve the scheme, it is still not binding on NCLT. NCLT can still decide whether to accept that particular merger or that scheme or not. NCLT can still reject even if it is approved by majority. So that's what I've been given here, and this is similar to the Mafatlal case, where it said that Supreme Court opined that courts before whom the scheme of amalgamation is placed. So now it is going to be NCLT before whom the scheme of amalgamation is placed for the sanction is not expected to put. So this is the part, not expected to put its seal of approval on the scheme merely because the majority of the shareholders have voted in favor. So the role of NCLT is here that they should check whether the scheme, so this is it's their objective, or it's their responsibility to find out whether the scheme is fair, just, reasonable, or and concerned to the member, and it should not be opposed to public policy. Because once NCLT approves the scheme, it becomes binding on all, even on the dissenting minority. So it is going to have a strong impact. Therefore, it's said that when a scheme is being approved by NCLT, NCLT needs to check this. So this is one particular scheme, and I think the same provisions were laid down in the Mafatlal case. Then you have this another case where it said that this was again Lotus Nico Hotels Travel Private Limited. This is a 2017 case. So it said that High Court of Delhi opined that where the scheme of arrangement providing for demerger stood confirmed and was made binding, it also bound creditors. So like it said that once the scheme is being approved, the scheme is binding on all, even on the dissenting shareholders, creditors, and everything. So is the scheme binding on the creditors of the company even if they have not specifically consented to the scheme? So answer is yes. So dissenting shareholder, dissenting creditor, even the employees of the company, everyone. So it's binding on all. So the NCLT order for the scheme of arrangement, whether it's for merger or demerger, it will be binding on all. Then you have this case. So this is again an interesting case. If you remember, we discussed about the Ajanta Pharma case, where the NCLT had actually rejected the scheme because the income tax authority has raised the objection. So if you remember, in section 230, the copy of the scheme has to be sent to the regulatory authorities, which also includes the income tax authority. So here the income tax authority, they raised the objection, they invoked GAR, and they said that this entire scheme of amalgamation is basically to evade the tax, right? So it's only to evade the tax, and promoters are going to do tax evasion with particular scheme, and NCLT Mumbai actually rejected this particular scheme. This case is also similar to like that, right? So here if you see, there was a listed company and there was an unlisted company. Okay, so the unlisted company was the transferor and the listed company was the transferee company. Now both the companies, they had the common promoters, and it was held that, so NCLT observed that 99% of the shareholding of the transferor company was held by the promoters of the company, and in that case the transferee company, the listed company, is going to pay purchase consideration to this. So if you say this is the listed transferor company, okay, listed transferee company, okay, this is going to pay purchase consideration to the unlisted transferor company, okay. This is again 99% held by the promoters of this particular company only. So whatever purchase consideration is paid by this transferee company ultimately is going to the pockets of the promoter only. Therefore, NCLT held that, and in fact NCLAT also upheld the order of NCLT and it said that this is taking undue advantage to the promoters of the amalgamating company, because this company, this particular transferor company, VK Kids Limited, it had no business, right? It had, just see this, you will find it somewhere here. The transferor company had no business, it had got less worth, for which they were paying a purchase consideration of 12 crore. So this was technically, you are just paying the money, right, to the promoters of the company, and that's the reason this particular scheme was rejected. So if the scheme is providing undue advantage only to the promoters of the company, it is going to be rejected. Same, it happened in case of Ajanta Pharma case, where the IT authorities, they invoked GAR and said that the promoters are trying to evade the tax and it is not just to simplify the corporate structure of the company. So again, the scheme was being rejected. Then protection of minority interest. So again, we know that in section 230 subsection 7, NCLT has the right, or basically NCLT has the power to make provision for the dissenting shareholders, that is basically providing them the exit opportunity. Same power has been given in section 232, where tribunal will check whether the exit opportunity or adequate exit opportunity is given to the dissenting shareholders or not. As we discussed that the scheme, once approved, is also binding on the dissenting shareholders. So the tribunal plays a very vital role, and it is not only the supervisory role but also a pragmatic role, which requires forming an independent and informal judgment as regard to the feasibility and proper working of the scheme. And also, we know in section 231 NCLT has the power to modify the scheme, so they can also make the modifications to the scheme, issuing appropriate directions with the end of the view, so that the particular scheme meets the end result. So if there is only technical difficulty, only then the modification can be done, only for the proper implementation. So here, this is the Mafatlal industry case. And then you have this particular judgment. So there has been occasions where the minority shareholders have raised the objections and they have succeeded. So in this particular case, there was one shareholder, okay, a lone shareholder. He opposed the merger and he proved that there was willful suppression of the material facts, the malafide intention of the promoters in floating separate companies. Therefore, a lone shareholder apparently actually ensured that the merger was called off. So even a minority shareholder, even a lone shareholder can do. So if you want to remember, you can just remember this case, that in case of Tenwala Poly Containers Limited, or if you don't remember this, then you can just write in case of TPL and TCPL Limited, even a lone shareholder had opposed the scheme and he succeeded technically. Then you have this minority and majority rule. So majority rules the company, basically if there is nothing wrong, then in that case it's the majority who are going to rule the company. And Foss versus Harbottle, it is basically if there is anything which is within the powers of the majority shareholder and they are doing, they are allowed to do. But there is only exception to this particular case, where they are doing an ultra vires act. So if a act which is not within the powers of the company and the majority of the shareholders are trying to do that, then in that case again the majority rule will be set aside, and that particular action, whatever the majority shareholders have been taking, that would be set aside here and it will not be upheld. Then if there is a fraud which is happening on the minority shareholder, so this is again the majority minority rule will be invoked, and where the majority cannot just say that this is the decision which they have taken. If there is wrongdoers in the control, so where the majority shareholders, okay, they are the wrongdoers, in that case again it will basically invoke this minority protection rule. And minority shareholder in the straddle of power cannot be allowed. So this is basically, it's basically opposite to this. It says that just because a minority shareholder or a dissenting shareholder has the right to oppose the scheme, doesn't mean that they can just straight away come and oppose the particular scheme without any sufficient cause. So this is the LIC case, right? LIC versus the Escort. And then mere lack of confidence between the minority and majority shareholder, this will not be enough. We also did in the case of valuations that there are multiple ways to value a particular company. So just because my valuation method is different than yours, it doesn't mean that the valuation which has been approved by the majority is wrong and it can be challenged. So it cannot be if the broad parameters are met and they are fulfilled. Similarly, a series of illegal acts can lead to the conclusion of some part of a oppressive transaction. So this was the needle industry. So operation is not a single act. Operation is a series of acts. So it's not that one act has been done and that is oppressive. There are series of transactions which are happening, and then you can say that okay, this particular thing has been happening from quite a long time, hence this is what this is operation. Then again, this was the case where a complaint was made regarding the violation of the statutory and contractual rights. Shareholder may initiate the proceeding in the civil court, right? So this was earlier the section. So right now what you have, section 241 for operation and mismanagement, it was section 397. So it said that the section 397 would be invoked when there is operation, and it's alleged, it is necessary that it is alleged that illegality in the conduct of the majority of the shareholder, these have to be proven, only then you can file the case for operation and mismanagement. So I think these are some of the cases which were there in the module, right? And you can just go through these cases. I don't think so, apart from this, there is any other case that you need to do. Those that I have already covered while taking the revision sessions for section 230 and 232, of course that you need to do, plus the cases that I have covered while doing valuation, that you need to do. These are some additional cases which you can just go through, like I had mentioned in the LDR session also, that I'll come up with one short video with respect to the cases. Okay, so that's it for this particular session. Happy learning.